Welcome back to another episode of Catamount Connection. We are really excited about this one because we're now joined by the new head coach of UVM men's hockey team, Todd Woodcroft. Coach, really excited to meet you and get you on here. So thanks so much for doing this. How you doing? Welcome to Catamount Country.
Morning, Michael. I'm very excited. This is a dream come true. I'm walking into something where everything is built. The foundation has been laid. All the coaches before me have done such a good job creating this culture. And then for me, selfishly, to walk into a city like Burlington, which is so hockey crazy in a good way and so supportive of this team, that I'm just tickled, because this is a once in a lifetime opportunity and something I've been looking forward to my whole career as a coach, and now I have the opportunity to do it on such a great campus, such a great community. I couldn't be happier.
So I know you've done dozens of interviews, and we tried to mix it up and get some UVM fans to reach out and ask you some questions. So we're just going to start firing those off. We'll start with Rich Palmer, who wants to know, with many of the coaches that you've worked with over the years, who would you say you draw the most inspiration from and hope to emulate as a head coach?
Well, thank you, Rich. That's a great question. I think first that you, as a coach or as a person in general, that you are really a product of all your influences. So early on in my career, when I started coaching, I was with a man by the name of Jacques Lemaire, who would be familiar to most people up in Cat hockey country because the proximity to the Montreal Canadiens. And Jacques was a Hall of Fame player, but he's one of the best coaches that ever existed, I think. And he was a gentleman. So I learned a lot of things from Jacques. And then from there, I was able to work with a guy named Mike Babcock in Hockey Canada, who was a huge influence on me. Joel Quenneville was there. I got to work with a man by the name of Glenn Hanlon, who was a goalie his whole career, and how he got to see the game from a goalie's perspective for me was very, very interesting. From there, I was able to work with a lot of coaches internationally. I worked with Dave Lewis, who was an excellent influence on me. And then going into my time with Team Sweden and seeing a guy like Rickard Grundberg, who's an up-and-coming modern coach, and the way that he did things with the Swedish players, where the Swedish players, they actually have a great partnership with the coaches. And I learned a lot from him on that. And then obviously the last couple of years, I've been able to work with a man like Paul Maurice, who has taught me daily what it takes to be a professional and to be a man who takes care of his players and cares about the people that he works with deeply every day, and even the whole staff there. Jamie Compon, who actually my whole life has been a major influence on me as a player who was not very good, into helping me get my start everywhere in the NHL, and has molded me my whole career. And then, you know, you get to stand there with a guy like Charlie Huddy, who's won 5 cups as a player, and he's coached over 1,000 games, 1,500 games, I think, as a coach. And our goalie coach, Wade Flaherty, and there's our video coach there is a guy by the name of Matt Prefontaine. And to see the lens from how that job has evolved into the important role that a video coach has on a team. So all those people were, I guess, the biggest influences. I know it sounds like a lot, but each of those people has a little bit of a piece of me that has shaped me into who I am. But then really at the end of the day, you're really no greater influence on you as a person than your family. So whether it's your immediate family or whether it's your parents and brothers. So my 2 brothers, who are both coaches professionally, one in the KHL and one in the American League, have been such an influence on me, where our parents showed us right from the start about supporting each other, celebrating the wins, understanding the losses, and knowing that as a coach, you're going to have some up times, you're going to have some down times, but at the end of the day, we got to enjoy what we're doing for a living. So those would be the biggest influences on me that I've been lucky enough to be around my whole life.
It's a pretty good list. It's a long list, but certainly a good one. Owen Jenkins, who's a UVM men's hockey alum in the class of 71, he wants to know, what are your thoughts on how and where to recruit high-level D1 players? And he was wondering specifically if Quebec is going to be a target.
That's a great question, Owen. The first thing for me is really the what over the who when we build this team. So what we're trying to do when we're shaping the next generation of Catamount players. That's really more important than the who. That's almost before step one, where we're understanding as a coaching staff that we're not just collecting players and putting them in a jersey. We need to identify the ingredients that we want to have on this team. So when a player comes in, that player is going to fit the mold of what it takes to be a Catamount, and understanding that they have to earn the right to wear that jersey every single time they have the opportunity to put it on. And really every one of these athletes that we're going to be recruiting has to value first and foremost academics. They have to obviously love the campus and the community when they come and visit. We want people who celebrate being inside the greater Vermont community in Burlington. And then I guess selfishly for me, it's, I want to identify players who understand that it's a we, not a me attitude when they come into this team. So that's kind of the first step. I guess the second step is identifying the top players globally. So we want to recruit players who would have some ambition. We want to recruit players who have character. We want to recruit players who have some compete, and then obviously skill. And then now we show the why they would want to come to UVM, understanding that we're going to develop them as student athletes. We're going to develop them as community citizens. And then if they have the goal to be a professional player, it's the mandate of this coaching staff to give each one of these players individually the skill set that's going to be needed to go further in their career if that's what they want. So specifically in that question, Owen, I know you asked about Quebec. I think that's part of the backyard. Each coaching staff and each team and whatever league that you're in has to find the area that they're most comfortable. The tradition of unbelievable players that have come through Quebec and Hall of Fame people, and maybe it's not just NHL players, it's just great players that came through. And then when you get a Hall of Fame player like Marty St. Louis and Eric Perrin and all those guys who are just excellent players from before, of course we want to have a huge stamp in Quebec, and that's going to be somewhere we're going to target.
Have you gotten a chance to talk to a lot of the UVM men's hockey alums over the last couple of weeks?
I've been reached out to by probably about 18 or 20, and it's awesome because I'm familiar with every single one of them as players. And you know, when your phone rings and it's John LeClair and you think it's almost a prank phone call, and him just checking in on me and seeing how things are doing and seeing what a gentleman that John is and his passion for this team and going forward, or whether it's even local products like Tori Mitchell, who's there all the time living now, and you know, all the guys who've reached out, it's been great. So everybody wants to support this thing, and now it's my job to give them a program that they feel proud of. That the players and the community deserve to have. So that's something that has to be worked on every single day.
That's awesome. So Matt Elkin has a question that I actually like a lot too. He wants to know, as a coach in the NHL, how did you use analytics in your practices or games to evaluate performance of your athletes, and how will you continue to use that at UVM?
That's a big question, Matt. Analytics is really the future of this game. And it's kind of come on strong in the past, you know, 8 years or so, when analytics has been given a huge voice in the way that teams have been built. And for me, it's a big piece of the puzzle. So good coaching staffs will use analytics to weave into their narrative. They're going to use it for specific things like matchups of who you're playing against, personnel of who you're going to put on the ice at the right time. Even tactically, you can do it. Analytics will identify tendencies in the teams that you play. For me, it's something that's going to help shape how we build our game plan. Like, it's going to help us make some informed decisions. Our coaching staff is going to collect all the information. So for me, it's a piece of that, but it goes side by side with video. It goes side by side with the experience of the coaching staff. It goes side by side with some player input. And what we're going to also have is the eye test. So the analytics will give us some information that we need, but then it comes down to an eye test. So our analytics really is going to be dictated in how we practice. So we will use the analytics that we collect and how we practice for each opponent. And then really it's into how we're going to play.
Dave Sobzak wants to know who your favorite player growing up was and who your favorite NHL team was when you were a kid.
Wow, that's a great question, Dave, for me personally, because I remember being a young guy with my two brothers, Craig and Jay, and just like any other hockey playing family, especially in Canada, where it's such a fabric of who we are as people, just playing mini sticks and breaking my mother's Royal Doulton china in the china cabinet. But what we did there was we always would re-draft the NHL teams and put them into separate teams and make up team names. And we would track points for each of them and all just playing mini sticks. And specifically if I'm thinking of the players that I really enjoyed, I'd almost have to break it up into sections of my understanding of hockey. Like the first guy that I fell in love with was a player was Brian Trottier. I've always been really, really interested in how he approached the game and the craftsman he was as a centerman. And then Ray Bourque. Like for some reason, Ray Bourque was just my favorite guy as a player growing up. And then as you know, you start getting a little bit more aware and, you know, seeing how people are, players are as people as well. So you see a guy like Adam Graves, who was a huge influence on me watching and one of my favorite players, even still to this day, one of my favorite people. And Doug Gilmore was another one. And then as you become a professional, you start to see them, what they can do for your team and how you want your own players to aspire to be certain types of players. So I was a big Red Wings fan growing up and seeing a guy like Nicholas Lidstrom, Pavel Datsyuk, who I was able to see his evolution as a player was great. And then I guess if you look at this generation, if I could remove the Winnipeg Jets players because they're all my favorite, I guess I would say from the NHL standpoint, guys that I really enjoy how they play would be Ryan O'Reilly, I think, is an excellent, excellent player and an excellent leader. And then on the back end, guys like John Carlson or people that I enjoy watching, Jacob Slavin, like those types of players who I'm hoping the Catamount players are going to be able to watch and to see what it takes to be those types of players and then work on those habits every single day.
I'm doing the isolation thing in my parents' house right now, so I'm hoping that I don't have to break out the mini sticks and break my mom's china in the next couple of weeks. We'll see if I get that board.
I'm pretty sure that she doesn't want that either, so if that happens, you just tell her to call me, and I'll make sure we
All right, we got that. Don Heist wants to know, do you plan to play a more wide-open style or build your team from the back end and focus on defense?
Thanks, Don. That's a lot larger question. We'd probably need a few hours on that one. I think that any good coach coming into a team that has some very good structure already, I need to familiarize myself on what the strengths are. I want to see what the strengths are specifically of the upperclassmen and how we're going to develop them to get to their next level, wherever that might be. And then the staff's going to have to do a deep analysis of the younger players and the recruits that are coming in, because in my opinion, good coaches are coaches who coach to the strengths of your team. So we can say we want to be one thing, but if we don't have the players that are capable of doing that, we're not going to have any immediate success. And we want to build a winning culture, a competitive culture as soon as we can. So when I'm comfortable with understanding the players and who they are as hockey players, I'm already comfortable with them as people. But when we start to get on the ice and an ability to shape an opinion that way, we're going to build a game plan with the whole staff that we're going to form an identity of how we want to play kind of around the personnel. And not to cheat the question on you either, Don, I think that specifically I would like to be a possession-based team where we are going to put a premium on speed. We're going to put a premium on compete and then a collective work ethic that I'm hoping will make the citizens of Vermont and any fan of Catamount hockey proud.
All right. Now Sharon Williams, she wants to know, how do you plan to develop your own hockey program at Vermont? What's going to make your team different?
Thanks, Sharon. I think the first thing I'd say is this is not my program. I'm just the current steward of this hockey team and of all the people that have come before me. And I think that really, if you look at it as a coach, what you're doing is you're really working for the players. Of course, the staff and the alumni are going to have voices in everything we do, but the legacy left behind of Coach Sneddon and Coach Gilligan and Coach Cross, that's something that I want to make sure I honor every single day for the work that they put in, all the years that have gone in before me. So that's very important to me. So I look at it that way. I guess what makes me different there is that I'm going to have a continual quest to evolve as a coach and understand that this is really a craft, and I'm going to make mistakes, but I'm going to learn from them, and our staff is going to make mistakes and we're going to learn from them. But what I really like there is the word you had in being different. I like that, just listening to the question. And really, I think in any industry, whatever you do, if you're comparing yourself to other organizations, you're not really looking at what the good teams or good organizations have in common. You're looking at what separates the great ones. So what makes them different? So for us, we're going to try to play a little bit different brand of hockey from the other teams, specifically in Hockey East. And then at the end of the day, I'm going to have to be my own person, take all the information that's given to me as a from the staff and everybody that I trust, and listening to alumni voices, and just trying to make this thing my own, where I have to be my own person and let a little bit of my own personality come out there too, on the stamp of this team.
So our last question comes from a UVM Hall of Famer, a guy who you will see his name everywhere. His jersey's hanging in the rafters. His name's on everything. TJ Sorrentine, the class of 05. And he wants to know, what part of the developmental process are you looking to implement that you learned at the pro level that you think can be most initially effective with your new players in the NCAA?
Well, Mr. Sorrentine, thank you very much for that question. And I think you've broken it down into the essence of how we want to develop the players individually as well as collectively here. So if you can break down the habits and details of what it's going to take to be the best hockey player you as an individual can be, for me, the fundamental elements of that would be the skill set we're going to have. So in my experience, top players in any sports, they starve to be taught. They're always wanting to get better. So specifically to answer your question, it's about the repetition and the touches that we're going to do daily. You'd be surprised at how simple the skills really are when you get to it. But the pendulum I found in my experience coaching has actually swung now to where players want to have way more skill development. It's pretty easy to talk about systems and X's and O's, but at the end of the day, players, they want skill. They want a reason to show what they've learned inside a game. So we're going to have a staff that is going to be developmentally biased, meaning that we're trying to develop these players with all the skills that it's going to take. It's really a partnership with the players there. For me specifically, I believe that there is a soft skill and there's a hard skill. And the emphasis on these players for Catamount Hockey is we're going to be working on the hard skills of the game, what to do when you're challenged, what to do when you're uncomfortable. Obviously, Mr. Sorrentine's played at a high level and understands, even if it's a different sport, that there's situations inside the game where your competitiveness has to take over and you need to have a background inside your skill set of playing in those hard areas. So being uncomfortable yourself as a player, embracing that. And then now what we want to do is we want to make the other teams uncomfortable with by using that hard skill. Excellent question. Thank you very much. I'm honored to have received that question from you.
So I know at some point we're going to get TJ and you and all kinds of UVM fans and our community together in Burlington to get to meet you and everything. But until then, what do you want to say to Catamount Country as far as what you're looking forward to going into the next couple weeks, months, and into next season?
Well, the first thing I would say, Michael, is that I hope everybody's safe and healthy and that everybody that you care about is okay too. There's a lot more important things going on in the world right now than hockey. For myself, I just hope that there's going to be a little bit of optimism coming in here and understanding that I'm going to do every single thing I can to make the logo that I'm currently wearing right now proud of it, and understanding that as a coach and that as players that are on this team, that you have to earn that logo. They've been given an opportunity. I've been given an opportunity. Our coaching staff's been given an opportunity to represent the legacy of this logo. And that's not something that anybody that's going to be on our team is going to take for granted any single day. So I'm very excited to get to Burlington as soon as this stuff is over. Until then, I wish everybody all the best health for you and your families. And thank you very much for all the kind support that everybody has given to me. I have so many messages and emails from people that have just shown support in the tiniest ways. And it means so much to me. And I'm very thankful for this opportunity. And I'm going to work every single day so that people understand that I'll never take this logo for granted.
All right, Coach. Well, that's one interview with, we'll have many between you and I over the next couple of months. So thanks so much for doing this. And
Michael,
if
you break your mother's china, you and I are going to have a little bit of a discussion that might be off camera. And then we're going to get your mom involved, and then you're not going to like what your mom's going to say to you. So you just make sure that you take care of that stuff around the house for your parents.
Okay, all right. I'll be as helpful as possible. Thanks so much for doing this. We'll get you on again soon.
You're very welcome. Thank you.